Thank you very much for that kind introduction, Debbie. It's a really great pleasure for me to be speaking with you at the IQC and about this topic in particular, because many of you have worked in this area of quantum algorithms and know deep down the kind of challenges that we have. We need new quantum algorithms. It's one of the most desperate and pressing challenges for the field. And I'm very happy to now think that I can see something of a picture of all quantum algorithms together. And that's the story I want to share with you today under this grandiose title, The Grand Unification of Quantum Algorithms. And the way I'd like to frame this is in terms of the history of algorithms. As all of you know, I'm sure our three main pillars of quantum algorithms are factoring, simulation, and search. And these built on the earlier work that many pioneered, David Deutsch, Richard Joza, Vazirani, Bernstein. But these are the models that we use today, factoring from Peter Shor, quantum simulations from Seth Lloyd, and earlier Richard Feynman's ideas, and Love Grover's quantum search. And they're very different in many ways. Yet, despite these differences, many things have happened. So for example, quantum phase estimation from Mick Kalamoska and company really generalized the idea of factoring into a direction where we could understand it better. Then Harold Hassedeem Lloyd applied this to linear systems in a very impactful way. Similarly, quantum walks grew out of and generalized quantum simulations, and other recent techniques have even connected dots to techniques from factoring, like linear combination of unitaries, which is now built on a particular idea of simulation for unitary Hamiltonians, sums of unitary Hamiltonians, which are sums of unitaries. Quantum search has also grown in scope and also in connections. Adiabatic amplification was a natural generalization of quantum search. And the adiabatic algorithm itself today, which is more of a continuous time algorithm, builds on quantum search. My own entry into this area was from the direction of nuclear magnetic resonances, which seems very disconnected. This is a challenge where a practical issue, and those of you who work with Dave Corey and company know, is that if you have an amplifier that is imperfectly calibrated and you'd like it to perform pi pulses or pi over two pulses, it'd be really nice to make it perform them well despite the lack of calibration or the fluctuation on a slow time scale of that kind of amplitude of its amplification. So thinking about that, my students and I came up with a technique which achieved in principle arbitrary accurate pulses, but this was a numerical result. And then after two of my recent graduate students, Ted Yoder and Guang Hao Lo, figured out how to make that provable and generalizable, we found a neat connection to the quantum search algorithm through a realization of a fixed point adiabatic amplification algorithm. Maybe this wasn't so surprising though, because really quantum search is about a single qubit evolving SU2, as I'm sure all of you now know from Richard Cleave's courses on the topic. On the other hand, if you look at simulation and factoring, they clearly involve multiple qubits in a very non-trivial way. However, it was really quite surprising to me when Guang Hao Lo, one of my graduate students, figured out a way to connect this composite pulses idea to quantum simulation. And with his algorithm called the quantum signal processing algorithm, he obtained the best performance for quantum simulation as an algorithm and achieved, saturated the theoretical lower bounds for it. So it was the best possible quantum simulation algorithm. Now, even more surprising than this, though, was a generalization that Guang Hao Lo and collaborators Andras Gilyen, Yan Su, and Nathan Weave continued to work on. And this is a result from last year, known as the quantum singular value transform. Not only does it encompass the quantum simulation ideas and the quantum search ideas, but also the quantum factoring ideas. And this is the story I want to tell you about today. So today's talk is really a pedagogical talk. It's a review, not of my work in particular, but rather a celebration of this paper by Gilyen, Su, Lo, and Weibe. And what I'd like to do is to share the story of this with you in outline and in detail in three steps. But first, let me begin with the kind of recaps of search, simulation, and factoring. Recall that the specification of the search problem can be thought of as follows. You're given a label A, and you are also have access to an oracle U, which will flip the sign of a marked element of the marked element that has value A naught. And your goal is to find this marked element value A naught. The simulation problem, you're given a Hamiltonian and you're told to challenge to simulate or approximate e to the minus iht, where h is Hermitian and this evolution is unitary. The output is a state, u applied to some state. The factoring problem, you're given a unitary, let's say, which multiplies modulo n. And your goal is to find factors of n, say n is the product of two prime numbers, where a is some other number that's co-prime to n. And it's remarkable that given this kind of unitary and powers of this unitary, importantly, it turns out that if you are able to find an eigenvalue, lambda, with high probability, this will give you the factors of n. So it seems like these three problems are really very different, and it's hard to say that they have anything in common immediately. The search problem of Love-Grover is really about single-qubit rotations in a multi-dimensional space, albeit, but it's about SU2. Simulation is about mapping a Hermitian operator to a unitary operator, many dimensions, many qubits. Factoring is about phases of eigenvalues. So for me to sit here and I'm not standing, for me to sit here and say to you that these three problems really have something fundamental in common, other than maybe they use qubits, it seems to be rather a big reach. But actually, even though these seem very different, they do share something really strong in common. And this idea turns out to be built on singular values. It seems like some of the graphics aren't showing up properly here, but I'll try to explain what's happening. This slide shows the definition of singular values just by way of review. It is something that is defined for any matrix, not just square matrices. So let's suppose we have a matrix A that's M by N. The singular value decomposition of this matrix is a product of three matrices, W, sigma, V, where W and V are square and sigma is diagonal. W and V are unitary. Let's say that W is M by M and U is N by N, and this sigma is diagonal. And the intuition behind this is that the transformation of one vector space by A to another vector space really has three different parts to it. So we can take this initial vector space and rotate it like by V dagger, then shrink the principal vectors of this by sigma, because it's just a diagonal matrix, then rotate again by W, and this gives them the full transformation. Now, this also changes the vector space itself, and because of this, it turns out this concept of singular values and singular value decompositions is incredibly useful for a variety of fields. In machine learning, this is the basis of principal component analysis. In collaborative filtering, this gives low rank approximations. In model solving, this is the basis for a variety of pseudo inverses when you want to take the inverse of a matrix and make it stable. And even in quantum information theory, we use singular value decompositions as the basis for entanglement studies like the Schmidt decomposition. I hope that actually singular values and singular value decompositions ought to be even more valuable than this to the realm of quantum. One of the reasons is because the SVD applies to any matrix, not just to unitary or square matrices. And also these diagonal elements, which hold values known as the singular values, also are interesting because the singular values are in a range of 0 and 1 and they're positive numbers. Positive or zero. And they therefore are natural to interpret if you do this construction in the right way as measurement probabilities. On the other hand, they might not sum up to one, so you have to be careful. So there are some catches here. Still, it would be kind of neat to see where singular values apply in quantum. The challenge is that the singular value decomposition in general is extremely hard to compute when the matrix is large. So people come up with tricks to do singular value decompositions without actually computing the SVD. For example, in collaborative filtering, what Netflix does is to compute the SVD implicitly using a stochastic gradient descent rather than by actually doing this three matrix decomposition, which would be impractical in their recommendation system. So what I sit here to claim to you is that this concept of singular values has a very, very important role in quantum algorithms. This fuzzy thing you see here is a closed bracket that's missing. So let us assume that we are given a unitary which now block encodes a matrix, which is mapping between a space pi and pi tilde, is this fuzzy thing that isn't showing up right here. And we will call this a unitary embedding of the matrix A. A is n by m, or m by n, and not necessarily square. And it defines these two vector spaces using the green pi's, capital pi's. U itself is unitary, and A is given by this projector, pi tilde u pi. And these two projectors project onto the left and right singular vector spaces. And if you are given this kind of a construction of U, then the following theorem applies, that there exists quantum circuits such that, and there are two theorems here. First, each plane defined by a common pair of left and right singular vectors can be manipulated independently as if like a individual qubit, SU2 qubit, without computing the SVD. This is remarkable to be able to access singular vector spaces without having to do the SVD itself. The second, and this, by the way, these are just colloquial versions of the theorems, and I'll give you the rigorous versions of them down a few slides from now. The second theorem that applies, the quantum signal processing theorem, is that each singular value can be transformed by a nearly arbitrary polynomial. So you can compute trig functions, you can compute inverses, you can compute all sorts of things as approximated by a suitable polynomial. And you do this independently, all singular values. So let's see why I assert these two theorems are remarkable for quantum algorithms. And that is, and this is really the overview of my entire talk in one slide, that you can take the search problem and recognize that it has natural singular vectors, which are the start state and the target state, and singular values corresponding to these singular vectors are just one. In this case, the overlap between the start and the target. And the embedding is of this C number, a scalar inside a unitary matrix. And if we can transform this from whatever overlap it initially is to the number one, then the start and the target would be then by become identical, and then you know the target state. So if you could perform a transformation through a polynomial which takes C to one, then you would be able to implement the search algorithm. But this goes further. In simulation, the matrix that's involved is a Hermitian matrix, and it turns out that the singular values of a Hermitian matrix are the same as the eigenvalues. So the singular vectors are the eigenstates, energy eigenstates, and the singular values are the energy eigenvalues. The embedding is a unitary encoding of the Hamiltonian. So H has to be a block diagonal in this U. And the transformation would be to turn, your goal is to calculate E to the IHT. And I claim that if you can compute cosine and sine of H and then add them up using cosine plus I times sine, then you would get E to the IHT. And I'll show you in a few slides how you do exactly that. And then of course is factoring. Factoring involves a matrix which you would like to find the eigenvalues phase lambda of. And singular values and eigenvalues are not the same thing. The singular values of a matrix are the square root of the eigenvalues of the matrix squared. So one way to transform from the desired eigenvalues that you want to the singular values that this algorithm will give you is to use this construction where you find the eigenvectors of I plus U in superposition, and you block encode this, and I'll show you how you can do this. And if you do this, the singular values turn out to be the cosine of the eigenphases. And then knowing this, you can back out what lambda is. And you do this using a binary search algorithm that thresholds on the value of cosine of lambda. And I'll show you how this works. But the main point I want to get across is that this recipe of constructing an embedding, knowing what the singular vectors are and the singular values, and then coming up with a polynomial to transform them the way you want, gives you the quantum search algorithm, the simulation algorithm, and the factoring algorithm. And all of this is in the paper by Gilyen, Su, Weibe, and Lo. And I find it utterly remarkable, maybe not as clearly described as one might hope, but I'll try to introduce that today. So this is the story of my talk. And what I'd like to do is to begin with search, then show you simulation and factoring. Let me also encourage questions during my talk. And if anybody has questions now, I'll go ahead and pause and see if there is one. Questions? Okay. By the way, for those of you who know much of this already, maybe you can reflect as I'm speaking about this, reflect on the remarkable paucity of use of singular values in physics. Okay, let me go ahead and tell you the story. And the story I want to begin with is that grows from the Grover algorithm through the story of arbitrarily accurate pulses and the fixed point amplitude amplification algorithm. My main point will be to get across the quantum signal processing theorem in the next few slides. Okay. In nuclear magnetic resonance, or if you're just working with an SU2 system, often you'll rotate a single qubit about an axis phi in the XY plane. The axis is in the XY plane by an angle, let's say phi from the X axis, and you rotate by an angle theta. So here's the axis phi, here's the block sphere, and then when you rotate it by theta, it's some angle like this. And you know very well that if you look for the amplitude of the transition between 0 and 1, this is just a Rabi oscillation that looks like this. So it's cosine squared or sine squared in this formulation. If you then do the same rotation and repeat it many times, but changing the axis rotation, not the amount of rotation theta, let's say with 3 pulses, suppose you do theta about the x-axis and theta about some weird axis here, phi being 1.5 radians, and then 0 again. And look at this response function, f of theta, then you get something funny that looks like this. And it has 3 lumps because it's kind of a superposition of 3, combination of 3 rotations, not superposition, combination. And then if you do 5 pulses, you can get something like this. And I tried to make this kind of squarish, just to give you the idea that you can combine these phases phi, which are the axes of rotation, to get all sorts of responses. And in fact, you can get responses that look a lot like the OR function or a majority function using sufficiently large numbers of phis. Now, going forward, I'll use the following notation. Let us say that we'll use D of these phases, phi zero through phi D minus one, and we'll call that R phi vector. And it turns out that this matrix element between here, it's 0 to 0, but you can imagine 0 to 1 does the same thing, will be a polynomial of order D, where D is the number of these phases phi. And this is the theorem of quantum signal processing. there are a few different versions of these. This particular one is called the QSP with reflections. Basically, if you have some polynomial, and this is an inverse problem theorem, if you have some polynomial of degree D, which is sufficiently well behaved, and these are reasonable conditions such as P can describe a matrix element of a unitary operator, then it turns out that there will exist a sequence of axes, phi, such that this matrix element between zero and R phi acting on zero, sorry, I left out the zero here, is the polynomial in cosine theta. And this, I think this is a truly remarkable thing. Not just that it exists, but furthermore, there is a strategy by which you can find it. Looking at this polynomial, you might think if you're a mathematician that this is familiar territory because of Chebyshev polynomials being polynomials of trigonometric functions. And indeed, this is well known in the field of discrete time signal processing. And there exists an algorithm called the Remez exchange algorithm that will find these phi values for you. So there has been a call for these kinds of, a need for these kinds of phases in the past. And what I'd like to show you is that this kind of a structure actually is related to, and maybe is the underlying reason how one can think about the Grover search, how the Grover search algorithm works. Recall that our goal is to find the marked element A naught, where A ranges in some two, zero to two to the N, and we have a oracle defined by this purple U. And this particular oracle flips the sign of a marked element. And the thing we want to minimize is the number of uses of this oracle. And classically, it takes about N calls, and quantum mechanically, the square root of N. There is a hidden qubit in the search problem, as is known well in textbooks. Suppose we start with an equal superposition state over all the elements in this domain. So this is over N elements, and then apply the oracle operator to this equal superposition. It flips one of the state's signs, namely the marked state, and leaves all the rest of the states unchanged. We may call these A naught and A perp. And let's keep this concept in mind of some marked element and its perp. And we can denote the angle of this by theta. That is, the minus sign versus the equal superposition here is some unknown angle theta. It's an angle because U is unitary. And this defines a Bloch sphere in the problem, also well known. In this figure and in the following, I'll say that the target state is the North Pole and the opposite state is the South Pole. And the initial state is some phi naught. And as we apply these oracle operations, we're going to flip the sign of this. The fact that there is a Bloch sphere in this problem is something we'd like to refer to as saying that the problem can be qubitized. And I'll come back to this more in the following. The two rotations that are involved in the search algorithm, I will now present here. As I said, it's textbook material, but I'm going to slightly change the usual notation. Keep in mind that theta is unknown and that the oracle rotates by an angle with a minus sine theta here, and the initial state has a plus sine theta over here. So when we apply the oracle operation, it flips the state around this A naught A perp axis. And normally the Grover algorithm does everything in this like a plane rather than using the whole sphere. And we can denote the fact of this rotation, the unitary oracle and the effect of the initial state defining this plane using an operator known as the Grover iteration. And the Grover iterate uses a construction that looks like this thing, which is going to be called in textbooks the inversion about mean operator eventually with some maybe other Hadamards and things around it. But I'm going to stick with this projector. And the reason is because I want to claim that you can do the following. If you can do a projector controlled knot on a qubit, another ancillary qubit, which starts out in zero, and then do a Z rotation around it like this. This is just a inversion about mean altogether, where you flip the sign of the case when you are in the initial state plane over here. So this is the overall Grover iteration or cooperation plus the inversion about mean. And you can see that this inversion about mean inverts around the initial state psi naught. And then we get the classic Grover operation of rotating by three theta going up like this. Instead, what I want to do is to recall what we had as a quantum signal processing. In quantum signal processing, we interleaved a operator which rotated around theta with a rotation around the z-axis. Before, I had split this z-axis like between 1 and 2 and said, well, we have a rotation around some axis phi, another rotation around another axis phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3. That's equivalent to this one. I've just combined the phis in a different way. So the important thing is that f of theta is going to be a rotation operator by theta, and it's interleaved with the z rotation, which is around, and these are around two different axes. And Grover's search algorithm, written out using the quantum signal processing scheme, looks like this. So f of theta is the Orc operation, and this pi controlled z rotation is one of the phis in the signal processing algorithm. When we realized this connection, we came up with a way to think about this as a solution for the fixed point search algorithm. So the fixed point search algorithm is when you don't know the number, let's say, of solutions, or you don't want to stop the Grover iterations at some point, you'd like nevertheless to end up at the target state no matter how long you run the algorithm. Then if you make these phases phi sub j equal to the Chebyshev polynomial construction, and I've written out the actual phases here, then it turns out that you can accomplish a search algorithm which grows the square root of n, so it's optimal. And then it wobbles around, but it never gets never goes back to the initial state like the original Grover algorithm does. And this is kind of neat in that it now utilizes the whole Bloch sphere. I'm showing it here inverted from the Bloch sphere I just used. So the target state is at the bottom instead of the top, and the perpendicular state is at the top in this diagram. And you can see how the evolution of the state now goes throughout the sphere rather than just in a single plane as the traditional Grover algorithm would. The point I want to make here, though, is that this came naturally from the identification of Grover's algorithm as an instance of the quantum signal processing theorem. And so the quantum signal processing theorem clearly has some interesting application for quantum search, although I haven't made any other connections at this point. What I'd like to do now, though, is to make those connections and build the rest of the story for you by taking you from this fixed point adiabatic amplification or fixed point amplitude amplification algorithm to the larger story, which is that of the singular value transform. So now in the next section, we'll get the rest of all of the quantum algorithms. Let me pause for a moment and see if there are any questions.
I have a question. May I? So I was wondering about this fixed point. What is the delta? That delta squared, is that a parameter that you set in the algorithm, or you can set it to whatever you want?
Yes, you can set it to whatever you want, and it's the amount that you'll allow the wiggle to be. So you can see in the plot here, I have a delta squared on the top. And that's the amplitude of the residual wiggle. And if you make delta large, then it can converge a little bit faster. If you make delta small, then it may converge slower.
So can you make it so that it really does converge and never really wiggles, like the amount of the wiggle approaches zero as time approaches infinity?
No, it turns out that if you make the wiggle go away completely, like you're suggesting, then you end up getting the red line shown here, which is the pi over three algorithm. So it does go away completely, but then it doesn't converge as square root of n, 1/√n. It converges slower. And it turns out this was well known in signal processing, which gave us our first hint of why. But thanks, Richard, for the good question. Other questions? Okay. So from this set of the part of the talk, just remember the construction that if you have D of these phases phi, you can get a polynomial of order D in the resulting unitary. And this rise and wiggle behavior is a classic well-known property of Chebyshev polynomials. So back to singular values. Recall that the singular value is defined for any matrix M by N, and that I'm going to use W sigma V dagger as the decomposition, and that there is a right singular vector space and a left singular vector space, and there are different spaces. For each singular value sigma, which is one of the elements in this diagonal matrix, a plane is actually defined just like we saw for the Grover algorithm by a right singular vector V sub sigma and its perp, just like the block sphere I just showed you. Moreover, there's also a matching plane defined by W sigma and W sigma perp, where these are the the singular vectors of the left singular vector space, and they're connected by sigma in the middle. What Gilyen, Weibe, Low, and Yuan showed is that this unitary operator U, which is a unitary block encoding of the matrix A, it clearly maps from the right singular vector space to the left singular vector space, but most importantly, it's a rotation on this two-dimensional plane, V sigma and V sigma perp. It rotates on this plane and then it maps to the W plane. And if you understand this, and I did not before I read their paper, but if you do understand this, the following remarkable result occurs. So let me disentangle this quantum circuit for you for just a moment. Look at this, there's a U dagger U. So that means we take whatever is coming in, the U dagger is gonna move from the left singular vector space to the right singular vector space. And the U is going to move from the right back to the left. So we enter in some space and we'll exit in the same space. But in the middle, we have access to the right singular vector space here, and we have access to the left singular vector space here. And the theorem goes to show that if you interleave, insert in between this U dagger and U a Z rotation, and insert another Z rotation here, then it turns out that you will transform the singular values of the matrix A by polynomial, where this polynomial is an order D polynomial given by the quantum signal processing phases phi, where the phi is this phase of the Z rotation here. This is just Grover's algorithm now, but with the recognition that there are two vector spaces, two block spheres involved, one for the singular left singular vectors and one for the right singular vectors. This is the most remarkable thing, I think, of their whole paper. And it arises from Andras Gilyen's understanding of the singular value decomposition, because he writes about this in earlier papers that he's written. And for him to put that together with the signal processing theorem from the last few slides, I think is a truly insightful piece of work. Okay, now why is this so insightful and useful? Let me now apply it. So for example, let's look at quantum simulation. Our goal is to take a Hermitian operator H, which is the sum of some local Hamiltonians, and we want to realize e to the iht, which is the cosine of ht plus I of sine ht. We can look at this cosine and sine as polynomials. Imagine that we are given a block encoding of h, let's say in the upper left block, as shown here. Then, so this is like a zero controlled h. And we don't really care what else is going on in the rest of this unitary encoding. And it might be kind of hard to get this unitary because h may have values. We have to be careful about the norm of h when doing this. Nevertheless, suppose we have this block encoding of h. Recognize that the singular values of h are the eigenvalues because h is Hermitian. And so I don't know why this is showing up poorly on Zoom, but this is a cosine. So this is the first oscillation of a cosine. It goes from 1 to 0. If we choose the quantum signal processing phases, phi sub k, such that the polynomial that's implemented is cosine of ht, then it turns out we can simply insert these phases, phi sub k, into the theorem I just gave you, and it will give you the cosine of ht over here. And thus you get a unitary realization in a block of cosine ht. You repeat this using, for example, the linear combinations of unitary scheme to get I times sine of ht, and the result of this is e to the iht. And since the result is e to the iht and the upper left block is unitary, you can get that to be dominant. And this can be made deterministic and not have to do any pulse selection and so forth. Okay, so that's simulation in a single slide. I realize this might go a little fast, so therefore let's go even faster. Let me also emphasize, you do not need to know the singular value decomposition of H in order to accomplish what I have just shown. All right, as you might expect, this saturates the optimal bounds for both time and in terms of the simulation error epsilon and the dense sparsity of the Hamiltonian. Okay. So going even faster, let's suppose that now we want to factor using the singular value transform. Recall that we are given a unitary operation which multiplies its the number given to it, a basis vector x, by some a mod n. And our goal is to find the eigenphase lambda of this unitary. If you block encode u doing this, so this is a 2-qubit circuit, where you do a controlled Z on the first qubit, excuse me, not 2-qubit, 2-block. The first one is a qubit, the second wire here is many qubits on it. And this is a controlled U to the power S, so that we have a block encoding of I plus E to the I theta U sub F to the S power divided by root 2. If you have this block encoded matrix, so that's purple U here, the singular values of this are essentially cosine of the phase that we're looking for, lambda, to some power with some offset. And you can choose phi to give you a polynomial, which is a step function like this. Let's say its transition happens at the value 1/2, because the singular values are going to be in a range of 0 to 1. And if we suppress all the singular values below 1/2 and then amplify all the singular values above that to being equal to 1, and of course a polynomial will be much more graceful, then what you would obtain is a way to have your search space at each point. Let's say you start with S being very large, then lambda is either going to be 0 or pi. And you can set your threshold at pi over 2 and then determine whether that value of lambda is on the left or the right-hand side of the unit circle. And this lets you do a binary search using quantum singular value transform. And if you iteratively change S and theta until you converge to some desired convergence criteria, then you will find the bits of lambda one at a time. And even though I assert this here, if you have any questions and don't completely believe me about this, you can do problem 5.3 in the textbook I wrote with Michael on page 243. Michael and I attributed this to Alexei Kitaev, because this is the original way that Kitaev constructed his factoring algorithm with no Fourier transform. You just do controlled powers of u, you replace u with u to the k, and by changing k appropriately and by repeating this and feeding back so you can change the phase over here appropriately, you get something which pops out and looks exactly like the quantum Fourier transform. So I claim that modular exponentiation, that's a u to the s power, and the quantum Fourier transform emerge naturally from this binary search over the singular values. And this gives you the factoring algorithm. There, factoring in one slide. All right, but even this is not fast enough. Let's look at Harrow-Hasidim-Lloyd. Harrow-Hasidim-Lloyd almost explicitly starts with a block encoded matrix A and some u. And its goal is essentially to construct the inverse of A. Well, what's the inverse of A in terms of singular values? It turns out that that's just a polynomial which takes a singular value and replaces it by 1 over the singular value. And if you have this polynomial, then you get the inverse of the unitary matrix. And so that's Harrow-Hasidim-Lloyd in one line. And in fact, not only can you do 1 over the singular values, you can do any polynomial function of A. So you can be much more creative about this and go way beyond the Harrow-Hasidim-Lloyd algorithm. Okay, so actually this is all I wanted to share with you. I hope that you can appreciate that the singular value transform really does cover and give you factoring, simulation, and search. Beyond this, there's a lot known about what it does do, but there's a lot not known yet about what this can do. For example, it's known that you can do many more matrix functions, including functions which are useful for machine learning. And also, essentially, every quantum walk algorithm can be turned into a singular value transform algorithm. And the direction I'm going on personally is to show how singular value transforms can be used to solve some very interesting quantum channel discrimination problems, so that this goes beyond just algorithms, but also to sensing. So with that, I conclude. Thank you.
So I want to forward some questions from the chat box. The first one is, has any new algorithm been found because of this unified way to look at the algorithms?
Right. So I think that there are matrix functions that are presented in the paper by Gilyen, Low, Su, and Weibe, which have not been explicitly constructed before. But actually, if you want a much more general answer, not tremendously, not yet. You might call quantum channel discrimination techniques quantum algorithms. If you're that generous, then maybe the answer would be yes.
The second question in the chat box is whether this is going to be publicly available. I suppose we formally ask Ike if it's okay to share the video, but.
Sure, if you want slides, send me an email and let me I'll send them to you.
Okay, thanks. Then I open the view for additional questions.
Could I ask a quick question?
Sure.
So this is about the fixed point quantum search. So in the regime of very low error, like quantum search has this amazing property that the number of queries goes like square root n log 1 over epsilon underneath the square root. Is it possible to reproduce that using the fixed point techniques?
Honestly, I don't remember. I think the answer is yes, but it depends on the knowledge that you have about a bound on the number of marked elements, let's say. So if your bound is good, then I think it would give you that log factor, but Otherwise, it's going to be worse than that.
Thanks.
And actually, if it's only one and you know that it's bounded around one, then the answer is going to be yes, it'll give you that factor. Because you can get Grover's standard search algorithm out of it as a natural consequence of its parameters.
Thanks.
Hi, I'd like to ask a question about opportunities for near-term experimental realizations. Do you have a wish list of things that could be done in the lab that would maybe demonstrate the value of those algorithms?
Sure, that's a great question. Actually, if you look at this as a quantum computer architect, I think the first thing that should occur to you is that this is fantastic for building quantum computers because it gives you one common framework for doing all of the algorithms. Instead of saying that you have to build a Fourier transform and you have to build something different for doing search, you can just now build a box which does this circuit, modulo everything that Zoom has erased. But the idea would be you have some block encoding, then you do all these phases that are realized by projection controlled Z rotations. And now the key becomes, what kind of block encodings can you realize with your physical system? So let me give that as a challenge to experimentalists. By the way, Lin has taken this further and shown that using this singular value transform and its set of ideas, you can build benchmarks for experimental realizations that are analogous to the Linpack problem. I'm not entirely sure of the causality. He might have chosen this problem first to solve rather than getting the result, because it's such a nice name for him, the quantum Linpack.
So I want to forward another question from the chat box from Aggie. If you just naively start trying different transfer functions, transform functions, do you expect to lead to anything useful?
Ah, what a nice question. And actually, let me answer that by reflecting it back to you, which is notice that this reduces all of the algorithms into a vector of real numbers, phis. So why not just search for these real numbers phi using say, machine learning algorithm? You might just be able to optimize them and write a loss function, which says, optimize over the phis until you achieve such and such loss minimization. And one of those loss functions might give you Shor's algorithm, another one might give you Grover's algorithm, and another one might just solve an interesting problem that you have. But here's the clincher. In many ways, we don't know what singular values do in physics and quantum mechanics beyond principal components. Can anyone think of a good use of singular values that's natural in this realm? If you can, then I bet you can answer your own question.
So I'll take a turn myself. First of all, how does this way to look at algorithm change how we think we should handle fault tolerance in our algorithms?
Great. So I mentioned something about architecture, and this means actually that the central evolution of most of these algorithms involves a single qubit. Now, that single qubit is defined by this projector, you know, in some block encoding, and it's rotating around. So since that's the crucial set of dynamics, you don't care what else is happening in the rest of your Hilbert space. That means you probably could push a lot of faults, a lot of errors into the rest of this block encoded matrix up here. A second thing is that this actually gives you a very nice way to do variational quantum algorithms. In fact, there's a nice paper that came out earlier this year or late last year about a combination of this Kitaev method for factoring and variational quantum eigensolvers. It just said, why don't we bolt phase estimation onto VQE step by step, allowing you a few literal steps of phase estimation, but not the whole thing. This goes even further, because now you could have a variational quantum eigensolver that adjusts these phis. And it, of course, the hard part is going to be this block encoding. So we need to have something that's fault tolerant with respect to this block encoding, sufficiently fault tolerant. But it admits all sorts of very interesting novel approaches to where you can put errors.
The second question is, how would that change, say, for example, how we simulate non-unitary dynamics like the Lindblad evolution?
Right. I really like that question. And I don't have a good answer, but you can imagine the following challenge. How do you simulate quantum open system dynamics in general? Suppose you're not just given a Lindblad, but you want to simulate something complicated at this boundary between quantum and classical. You know, Feynman's original vision didn't quite encompass this. He said, just simulate pure quantum systems. But the majority of real physical systems like molecules really sit at this complex boundary of quantum classical, where it's semi-classical and semi-quantum. And I think that this technique of singular value transforms opens the door significantly to that. But there's a challenge here. I'll give one example very briefly. You know, as a physicist, that much of the simulation we do, when we solve a complicated problem, we don't solve the Hamiltonian by diagonalizing it. We do things like moving into the interaction frame. So this singular value transform allows you naturally to move into the interaction frame in a neat way. I don't have a citation shown here, but Nathan Weibe and Guanghao Lo had a beautiful paper about quantum simulation in the interaction frame, which built on some of the ideas shown here for quantum simulation by singular value transform. Maybe the key idea they used was qubitization, which is the block encoding of the Hamiltonian.
Thanks. So there's another question in the chat box. How large does the total unitary matrix have to be? How much larger is it than the block matrix A?
Right. So it needs to be only as large as what is needed to make this block a part of a unitary. So you can come up with lower bounds and upper bounds on that. I don't happen to have them off the top of my head, but maybe it would be sufficient for it to be at least as the same dimension as this block over here. But it may be easier to implement if you made U larger. Other questions? By the way, coming up with good block encodings is a challenge. I've been thinking about how to block encode like harmonic oscillators. And it's not entirely trivial to do it in a good way.
So we have one more question in the chat box. What is the connection between the factoring problem and linear system problem?
Oh. Well, let's see. In this technique, in this rendition of the linear systems algorithm, there is no application of phase estimation as a building block in this construction. But the way HHAL made their construction was to use the factoring algorithm to give access to the eigenvectors, and then essentially get A inverse by inverting the eigenvectors. If you recognize that much of the big point of singular values is to give you robust pseudo inverses like the Moore's-Penrose pseudo inverse, then you can do it directly and not even have to bother with thinking about the phase estimation algorithm. I hope that answers the question. Maybe Richard can give it as a final exam question in the class.
Yeah, when you say that it's one page proof for a certain algorithm, I was starting to think that yes, we'll start to include this in our qualifying exams.